We all know the Battlefield 2042 gameplay trailer launched yesterday, and with everyone and their mom making reaction and analysis videos, I thought I'd take the time to do something a little bit different. What's up everybody, welcome to Capture the Frag, your one-stop shop for all shooter gaming news. I'm your host, XBLUMONKEY, and today we're talking everything we know about the 17th installment in the Battlefield series, Battlefield 2042. Guys, if you find the video useful, a thumbs up down below would be much appreciated. And if you want to see more videos just like this in the future, be sure to subscribe, hit that notification bell. Let's jump right in. So first, we'll cover the nitty-gritty technical stuff. Game releases on October 22nd, 2021. That's actually pretty soon, considering that the reveal trailers just launched. I mean, that's only 4 months away. It's coming to Xbox One, the Xbox Series, PlayStation 4 and 5, and PC. So you can basically play this on anything except a Switch. So for the price, basically the way it works, it's gonna cost 10 bucks more if you are on one of the next gen consoles. So the base edition is gonna be 60 bucks, or it's gonna be 70 if you have an Xbox Series X or S or PlayStation 5. The gold is gonna be $90 or 100 on next gen consoles, and the ultimate edition is $110 and 120 on the next gen consoles. With gold, you get early access to the game's launch as well as the year one pass, which includes 4 new specialists. You get 1 per season and 4 battle passes as well, 1 per season, as well as 3 epic skin bundles. With the Ultimate Edition, you get the same thing, but you also get a legendary outfit, weapon, and vehicle skin. Now, it just says vehicle skin, so I'm not sure. Vehicle skins might apply across the board to all vehicles. We'll just have to wait and see. And you also get a digital art book and a digital soundtrack. Now, if you pre-order the game, no matter what version you purchase, you will get access to the open beta, and there's gonna be an open beta and a closed beta, and I'm gonna talk about that in just a second. Also, if you pre-order, you get something called the Baku ACB 90 Melee Takedown Knife. Sounds pretty badass. You also get a weapon charm and an in-game player card and tag. Now, the system requirements for the game are not yet announced. However, estimates have been getting thrown around the internet, and so I'm gonna give you, for the recommended settings, we're likely looking at for CPUs an Intel Core i7-5820K or an AMD Ryzen 5 2600. As far as RAM, you're gonna want 16 gigs, but people are thinking as far as GPUs that you're gonna need to play at recommended settings at GeForce RTX 3070 or Radeon RX 5800. Now, I am far behind this. I might just have to go ahead and upgrade my PC, or maybe get my hands on a PS5 if I ever can. As far as storage, however big the game is, like I said, they haven't told us any specifics like that. Probably big, just because of all the assets, but it is just going to be multiplayer. Again, we'll get into that in a little more detail in a second. So for a general look at the game, it is in the near future, right? It's 2042, so about 20 years away. Now, we've done far future this and we've done far future that. This aesthetic and this vibe and this kind of theme that they're going with in this game, I think it's what the shooter genre needs right now. So it's a sandbox PvP military shooter. PvP meaning player versus player. If you're unfamiliar with the series, it's basically just big, giant military battles, like very big, which I will get into in just a second. This time around though, the emphasis appears to be more about fun and not necessarily about realism. And we can tell this by the Pathfinder / Titanfall 2 style grappling hook, which appears to have unlimited charges and no cooldown. But don't worry, there's no wall running or double jumping or anything like that, at least not that we know of. And the last thing we need is another Call of Duty Infinite Warfare situation. So to get a little bit more in depth about the setting and the situation and kind of the theme that's going on here, I'm gonna go ahead and quote Tech Radar. They say Battlefield 2042 is set in a world that is on the brink of complete devastation. Food, energy, and water shortages have led to, quote, the greatest refugee crisis in human history, following the failure of many of the world's nations. Among these refugees are the non-patrioted, also known as NOPATs, made up of families, farmers, engineers, and soldiers who have been left without a nation to call their own. The last two superpowers that remain are the United States and Russia, who are battling it out for control of the globe's last remaining resources. In order to survive, non-PAT specialists join both sides so that when the final bullet is fired, they, quote, have a seat at the table. Players will take on the role of these no-PAT specialists. Haven't you guys noticed that in literally every military shooter, it's always the United States versus Russia? Like, is this propaganda? Are they indoctrinating us or something? I don't know. Now, I mentioned that there would be a beta test. There's actually going to be 2. The closed beta is going to be invite only for Battlefield veterans. This is happening in July. It's probably going to be a pretty small test, and they have confirmed that the people who are involved are going to have to sign non-disclosure agreements. But the open beta, you will get access to just if you pre-order the game. So that's a pretty sweet incentive right there. There's no date confirmed for the open beta. Match size will be up to 128 players. That's 64 players per team. This is the first time they've gone this big. So with a map that size, basically the way they're working it out is that the map will be divided into sectors, and each one of these sectors is going to contain a cluster of control points. In order to control the sector, you have to control all the control points. That's just a quick rundown. I'm going to talk about multiplayer modes and maps just a little bit farther into the video. So instead of using a class system, they're going with a specialist system, which is, let's be honest, basically the same. Four specialists have officially been revealed, and a couple have been discovered through the gameplay trailer. So the first one is Wickus Casper Van Dale. He's a recon class. His specialty is the OVP recon drone, and his trait is a movement sensor. We also have Webster McKay, who's an assault class. He's the guy that has the grappling hook, and his trait is called Nimble. Not exactly sure what that means. Then we have Maria Falk. Her specialty is a pistol that heals people, and then her trait is called Combat Surgeon, which they say means that when she revives people, they revive at full health. This kind of implies that anybody's going to be able to revive, but that hasn't been confirmed. The next specialist that we have is an engineer named Pyotr Boris Guskovsky. Man, just trying to pronounce that, a Russian accent came out. His specialty is the SG-36 Sentry Gun, and his trait is called Sentry Operator. And like I said, there's another two that had been discovered in the gameplay trailer. One of them has a riot shield and one of them has deployable cover, or at least that's how we know. Definitely one of them has a riot shield. Maybe he has the deployable cover as well, but we just saw another player standing behind that deployable cover. And what's cool here is that this time around, weapons aren't tied to classes or specialists, which is just gonna create a whole lot more variety and a freedom as far as how you wanna, you know, how you wanna play the game. Like, what's your play style? How do you wanna customize that? You're just gonna have a lot more freedom to do stuff like that. And then specialists can also change their weapon configuration on the fly. There's a new system called the Plus system, which you saw in the gameplay trailer. Basically, it allows you to change your scope, barrel, barrel attachment, and ammo type on the fly, which I think is actually gonna be really, really useful and not just like a cool, neat feature, especially with maps like this where you have big, long distances that you're fighting across, and then next thing you know, you're inside of a building. You can kind of just hot swap from your long range attachments to your close range attachments. Okay, let's move on to gameplay. First of all, dynamic weather. Like, come on. Sandstorm, tornadoes, and apparently both at the same time. Like, this is really a stepping stone for the game. When we talk destructive environments, we always just assume that it's the players destroying it and only the players, not here. But when we're talking about destructive environments, I haven't seen any of the buildings fall. And also, wingsuit, hello? And this is where the sandbox element comes in, where they design not only things that happen in the environment, but also ways that you can interact with that. Obviously, I'm referring to the wingsuit through the tornado. It's just really well thought out. And I think this game is going to really deliver a very exciting experience. So we're also getting a couple new weapons, the M5A3, the K30, and the AV9. And apparently vehicles are going to be a lot bigger of a deal this time around. According to EA DICE, they say that vehicles are a platform for great team play. Basically, each seat in the vehicle is going to have a vital role to play. So it looks like there's not really ever going to be a situation where you jump in the passenger seat of a vehicle and you're kind of just sitting there, which I also think is going to encourage people to get in vehicles together, especially if they're not actively playing together. And so in the end, having more players in your vehicle is going to make it more efficient. And by the way, also, as we saw in the gameplay trailer, and we're not exactly sure how this works yet, but you can request vehicle drops at any time to any place. There's not going to be any battle royale, and there's not going to be any campaign. Now, you can play single player against bots. I mean, if you really don't want to play with other people. And the cool thing is that the AI scales to the player's skill, and bot matches still count towards your progress. But as far as there being no battle royale or campaign, to me, this is a great sign. I mean, rather than them spreading their resources trying to make a bunch of different aspects to the game so they can appeal to like a larger audience, they're dedicating 100% of their energy to the multiplayer experience, which in the end, I think will draw more people anyway. I mean, would you rather spend your money on a mediocre game that has a multiplayer campaign and battle royale, Or would you rather spend your money on a kick-ass, unparalleled multiplayer experience? And speaking of game modes, there's going to be three distinct multiplayer experiences. One thing, actually, before we dive into specifics, and this is going to disappoint some people, but this is just how it is, and this is how it needs to be. If you're playing on Xbox One or PS4, you're not going to get the 128 player maps. What you're going to get is a scaled down 64 player version, and that's simply because PlayStation 4 and Xbox One, the hardware is just not going to run it. It's just too much stuff happening at once. So that's just kind of how it is. That's really sucky, especially considering how hard it is to get your hands on some of these next-gen consoles and, you know, with how expensive PCs are. EA DICE does say, though, that, quote, the gameplay, events, and moments will all be felt for Battlefield players on whatever platform they play on. So as long as they do a good job of scaling down the maps and keeping a tight map design, I don't mean like close quarters tight, I mean like well developed. I don't want them to see shrink the map, take some elements out, make it smaller, make it 64 people and call it good. It needs to be for those people who are still on PS4 and on Xbox One. They need to make sure that they still dedicate time, energy, and love to those downscaled maps in order for them to have that same experience. So moving back to game modes, Conquest mode's your standard Battlefield experience, basically. It's less structured and each game is gonna play out just a little bit differently. Basically, the way the players choose to play is gonna decide kind of the flow of battle. And so then that's gonna create moments where there is a lot of people fighting at one time. And it's also gonna allow for moments that are, as Tech Radar puts it, less chaotic and more personal. Second game mode we have is Breakthrough. This is the more structured game mode. Basically, it's one side attacking and the other side defending, and you're basically going to see both the teams come together in big team battles. Now, they categorize Conquest and Breakthrough underneath the umbrella of, quote, all-out war. There's also going to be two other multiplayer experiences, as they call them. So the second multiplayer experience, they call it Hazard Zone. It's a, quote, all-new, high-stakes, squad-based game type for the Battlefield franchise. Now, that's all they've said about it. It's squad-based. It's different in some way, we're not quite sure. And then there's also a third multiplayer experience set to be announced at EA Play on July 22nd. So the game's gonna launch with 7 different maps. It doesn't seem like a lot, but you have to keep in mind that with how big these maps are, basically they're broken down into sectors, and each of these sectors is essentially gonna be the size of an entire regular shooter map, if not bigger. And they obviously are going to be continuing support for this game, so we will see more maps down the line. There's a map called Kaleidoscope set in Songdo, South Korea. One called Manifest set in Brunei Island, Singapore. One called Orbital, and this is the one where you see the space shuttle take off. And this is kind of cool about Orbital. Tech Radar says this map sees a lot of action around the rocket launch and surrounding area, and the rocket can even take off, but apparently it doesn't always go as planned. Let's just say, I'm sure it's gonna change the battlefield in a devastating way. We also have a map called Discarded in Along India, one called Renewal, and this is in the Eastern Desert in Egypt. And I guess you're fighting over a groundbreaking agriculture technology center in the Egyptian desert. We have the Hourglass map, and this is the big neon city in Qatar. And then finally, Breakaway, taking place in Antarctica. And this is Battlefield 2042's biggest map, at 5.9 square kilometers. But guys, that is all I have for you. Thank you so much for sticking around to the end. Again, a like on the video is much appreciated. And if you want to see another video later this week and then another one next week, be sure to hit subscribe and turn on that notification bell. And until next time, guys, I'll see you in the next video. Peace.